Welcome to the video series, The Operational Amplifier, From Abstraction to Reality. This is part two about operational amplifier abstraction. I'll state again, I'm sure most of you are familiar with the use of the ideal op-amp abstraction, so feel free to skip over these topics. If you have been away from this stuff for a while, you may find it to be a useful review. Let's start this one with the difference amplifier. Here's the non-inverting amplifier configuration we looked at in part one. The op amp is indeed a differential amplifier, so all we need to do is remove the ground on the non-inverting input and put voltage there at VI1. Well, that does work, but there's a slight problem. Remember, the gain of the inverting configuration is minus RF over R1. But the non-inverting gain is 1 plus RF over R1. It follows that the gain of the non-inverting input will be 1 greater than that of the inverting input. To fix that, the classic difference amplifier has a resistor divider on the input to lower the input to offset the extra gain of the non-inverting input. We can write out the equation for VO with the VI 1 times the divider ratio, the non-inverting gain, minus the inverting gain, which is the product of VI2 and RF over R3. You remember how I told you in part 1 that the non-inverting gain expression in this form is more useful than the other? Well, that's happening here. The output voltage of the true difference amplifier is 0 if VI1 equals VI2. For that to happen, the ratio of R2 to R1 must equal RF over R3. Let's now rename the reference designators as necessary. Here's the equation for the output voltage with the revised reference designators. The R1 plus R2s cancel, and we are left with the differential input voltage times R2 over R1. Very simple. One downside is the input impedances of the two inputs are different. RI2 input impedance is R1, and RI1 is R1 plus R2. This means two sources of the same impedance would have different loads and would degrade the common mode rejection ratio. Of course, resistor tolerances will degrade the common mode rejection ratio as well. Lastly, the output impedance is 0 ohms. The instrumentation amplifier overcomes the issue of low and mismatched input impedances. It's the difference amplifier preceded with a non-inverting buffer for each input, making for infinite input impedance. To solve for VO, we use superposition of the inputs VI1 and VI2, with VI1 equals 0. The minus V terminal of U2 is at virtual ground, and U1 operates as a non-inverting amplifier. Its output voltage VO1 is given by the non-inverting output voltage formula we already are familiar with. Because there is a virtual short circuit between the V+ and the V- inputs of U1, the voltage at the lower node of R1 is VI1. U2 then operates as an inverting amplifier. Its output voltage is given by the inverting amplifier output voltage formula. Subtracting VO2 from VO1 gives us this and simplifies to this expression. U3 operates as a true difference amplifier, and its output voltage, VO, is given here. Now with VI1 equals 0, we get the negative version. By superposition, we get this expression for the output voltage, VO. Now we can make the expression for the voltage gain, AV, as VO over the difference between the two inputs, which yields this, a nice compact formula for gain. Let's say we want to design an instrumentation amplifier to have a gain of 100. That gain must be divided between the two stages. We can split the equation to separately solve for A2 and A1, and give each stage a gain of 10. Let RF1 be 10K and solve for R1, which results in 2.2K. Then RF2 be 10K and solve for R2, which results in 1K. We went through this superposition rigmarole to get where we are, but we could have done this by inspection. If we were to put a ground here, the input stage would have simply been like two non-inverting amplifiers. The beauty of this circuit is that the input does not involve ground. It is sometimes called an active transformer for that reason. Notice the 2 in the equation for R1. That makes the combined R1 be twice what it would have been with the ground. Another feature of this configuration is you can change the gain by only adjusting R1. Applications include strain gauge bridge interface for pressure and temperature sensing, a variety of low side and high side current sensing applications, medical instrumentation. It's actually used in ECG connections. It's used for power supply current and voltage monitoring. We will now take the input stage of the instrumentation amplifier and make a differential output amplifier. This circuit has two output voltages which have opposite polarities. That is, if VO1 is positive, VO2 will be negative and vice versa. Because the lower node of resistor R1 is at virtual ground, this equation can be used for VO1, simply the non-inverting output voltage equation. Because there is a virtual short between the inverting and non-inverting inputs to U1, the upper node of R1 sees the input voltage VI. This equation can be used for VO2, the inverting output voltage equation. In most applications of the differential output amplifier, the desired condition is where VO2 equals minus VO1. When this is satisfied, the amplifier is said to be a balanced differential output amplifier. This requires the condition where 1 plus RF1 over R1 equals RF2 over RF1. Multiplying each side by R1 reduces to RF1 equals RF2 minus R1. Each output voltage can be written with this expression. The difference between the two is each voltage doubled. Rearranging in terms of gain yields 2 RF2 over R1. Let's design it for a gain of 4. We will let RF2 equal 20K, R1 comes out as 10K, and RF1 also comes out as 10K. Let's now look at how the op amp can be used as a summer. The non-inverting summer is nothing more than a buffered passive averager. It's handy to use Milman's theorem for this. Here's the equation for the voltage at the non-inverting input, V+. It's the sum of the currents divided by the sum of the conductances. If you make weighting uniform across the inputs and make all 4 input resistors the same, you simply get the sum of the input voltages divided by 4. We now add the gain of the non-inverting buffer. Here's a general equation for any number of inputs with the gain adjusted to output, the algebraic sum of the input voltages. The inverting summer is the basic op amp circuit that's used to sum 2 or more signal voltages, or to sum a DC voltage with a signal voltage as an example. Here's an inverting summer with 4 inputs. If all inputs are grounded except the VIJ input, where J equals 1, 2, 3, or 4, the inverting amplifier equation can be used for the particular Jth input selected. Using superposition, the total output of the voltage is given by this equation. Let's try an example where we want to put a DC bias onto a signal. We will assume the plus and minus 15 volt rails are available. We want the output to be 3 minus 2 times VI. Here's the example circuit. The minus 15 goes in at one input, which gets inverted to a positive bias. R1 can be scaled to make the 3-volt bias we are looking for. We set minus 15 times minus RF over R1 to 3, and we set minus RF over R2 equal to minus 2. Let RF equals 3K, then we arrange and solve for R1 as 15K. And finally, rearrange to solve for R2, which is 1.5K. Here's the circuit diagram of an op-amp differentiator. A differentiator is a circuit which has an output voltage that is proportional to the time derivative of its input voltage. The circuit is similar to the inverting amplifier, except the resistor R1 is replaced by a capacitor. This equation can be used to solve for the voltage gain transfer function of the differentiator by replacing R1 with the complex impedance of the capacitor. Because a multiplication by S in the complex frequency domain is equivalent to a differentiation in time domain, the output voltage is given by this time derivative. The differentiator time constant is RFC1. Here's the circuit diagram of an op-amp integrator. An integrator is a circuit which has an output voltage that is proportional to the time integral of its input voltage. The circuit for the integrator can be obtained by interchanging the resistor and capacitor in the differentiator. The voltage gain transfer function is obtained by replacing RF with the complex impedance of the capacitor CF to obtain this equation. Because a division by S in the complex frequency domain is equivalent to integration in the time domain, it means that the time domain output voltage is given by this equation. Because R1 CF has the units of seconds, it's also called the integrator time constant. We have deduced by circuit analysis that this is an integral function because the Laplace variable S in the denominator, inasmuch 1 over S is the integral. But what's happening is very simple. When a step function happens at the input, due to the virtual ground, there is a constant current in R1. This constant current flows through CF since there's no current flowing into the op-amp input. Therefore, constant current in a capacitor makes it charge linearly. Let's design an integrator and test it out on the bench. The design will be based on integrating a square wave and producing a triangle wave output. Let's do this based on a 5 kHz square wave with a 50% duty factor. The pulse width over which integration occurs is 100 microseconds. The input will be plus 1 volt for the time of integration. The last half of the square wave will be minus 1 volt. The output will be designed to reach minus 10 volts at the end of the 100 microsecond positive half of the square wave input. We will let the feedback capacitor equal 0.01 microfarad. Rearranging the integrator to solve for R1, this yields 1 kiloohm. Here's what's happening after steady state conditions are met. As the input steps to plus 1 volt, the feedback capacitor charges, and over the pulse width of 100 microseconds, the output is a linear ramp going 10 volts negative. When the input steps to negative 1 volt, the output ramps to 10 volts positive, and the cycle continues. Here's the solderless breadboard in the schematic. I'm using a TL-082 JFET input op-amp just because I had some in my lab. It has dual 12-volt DC supplies. I also added R2 across the capacitor to help settle the output DC during frequency changes. There is a TL-082 op-amp. Here's that simple integrator circuit. On the scope, the input is in green, the square wave, it's plus 1 and minus 1, and then the output is 10 volts peak to peak, making a triangle from a square wave. If we change to a ramp input. You can see the output is a sinusoid, which makes sense because it's a low-pass filter. And if we put in a sine wave, we'll get a sine wave out, and since the integral of sine is cosine, it's a 90 degrees out of phase with the input. And going back to square, we can see how it changes with frequency, as you would expect. If you increase the frequency, the time that it integrates is smaller, so therefore the amplitude of the output will be smaller. And if you decrease the frequency, eventually it'll get to the point where the amplitude is so great that it starts clipping.